It's heartbreaking to stand here today, just days after 10 innocent lives were taken in Buffalo, New York, in a grocery store by a gunman espousing white supremacy, supremacist views, and hatred towards African Americans. This devastating massacre took me back to June 17, 2015, when another white supremacist gunned down 9 parishioners at Charleston's historic Emmanuel AME Church. In the intervening years, we have witnessed far too many other acts of domestic terrorism, from a counter-protest in Charlottesville, Virginia, to a synagogue in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, to a Walmart in El Paso, Texas, to a Sikh temple in Oak Creek, Wisconsin, and an Asian-owned nail salon in Atlanta, Georgia. All told, over 200 mass shootings this year. To be sure, all these shootings have not been racially motivated or motivated by hate, but all of them share one thing in common. They are all committed in a country too tolerant of irresponsible regulations of weapons of war and a proliferation of firearms for mass destruction. The Domestic Terrorism Prevention Act we passed yesterday is long overdue. It will enable the Justice Department, the Department of Homeland Security, and the FBI to prevent, investigate, and prosecute cases of domestic terrorism more effectively. I, and many of my colleagues standing with me today, know what it is to experience acts of racial hatred and witness events of domestic terrorism. We cannot continue to turn a blind eye to white supremacy vigilantes. It impacts all of us. While the gunman in Buffalo was aiming for people who looked like me, others who did not look like me fell victims to this evil act. Shortly after my first meeting with Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. back in 1960, I met with one of my professors, Ms. Rosa Harris, to share the Saul to Paul transformation I was experiencing. 2 days later, Mrs. Harris handed me a copy of Dr. King's 1958 book, Stride Toward Freedom, to share one passage from that book. I quote, "True peace is not merely the absence of tension, it is the presence of justice. The Domestic Terrorism Prevention Act will provide federal agencies with necessary tools to help ensure that peace and justice prevail. But we must do more. We must acknowledge this country has a problem with race. Until we do that, we cannot address the cause of these racially motivated crimes, and we cannot find adequate solutions." And I'm pleased now to yield to the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, Congressman Joyce Bailey.
Thank you, Whip Clyburn. I'm Congresswoman Joyce Bailey, and I am here today to discuss the replacement theory as a key plank in the Republican platform. I'm here to call out the Republican Party for making the racist replacement theory, yes, a plank in their Republican Party platform. As chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, I call for my fellow Tri-Caucus members and congressional leaders to stand in unity against this white supremacy conspiracy theory that perpetuates the racist, xenophobic, Islamic, and anti-Semitic lie that non-white immigrants are brought here to repopulate majority white countries and disempower white voters. This is a lie. It is a lie that is rooted in old school colorism and eugenic ideology that has already inspired multiple attacks on ethnic and religious minorities. My friends, we cannot be silent. Shootings in an African American church, a Pittsburgh synagogue, an El Paso shopping center, and a rampage at three spas in Atlanta. Time and time again, domestic terrorists are using the great replacement theory to justify their slaughter. Right here on Capitol Hill, we hear our Republican colleagues echoing versions of this theory. We must confront it. Let me say it in very clear terms. The Republican leadership is not innocent. And whether they use a dog whistle, a bullhorn, they do not get a pass.
That's right.
Last week, we watched an 18-year-old white supremacist and a replacement theorist killer kill 10 people in a mass shooting at a supermarket in Buffalo, New York. On Monday, three people in Korean-owned hair salons in Dallas were gunned by yet another white supremacy replacement theorist. We are seeing the pipeline from racist rhetoric to racist violence. I am asking the American people to join us and to speak out against this, to join us and demand Republicans do as Democrats did last year. So when the American people say to us and ask us, what have we done? What are we fighting for? And when we go home to our district, we can stand proudly because this speaker, this leadership has done her job. Let me remind you that last year, Democrats passed both the Bipartisan Background Checks Act and Enhancement Background Checks Act, and you may applaud on that. So lastly, to the Republicans who continue to obstruct gun violence legislation while amplifying the racist replacement theory, I have but one question. Tell me what you say to the far too many families who have experienced the senseless loss of family members and friends. Tell me what you say to the families of Aaron Salter, Ruth Whitfield, Pearlie Young, Catherine Massey, Deacon Haywood Patterson, Celestine Cheney, Roberta Dreary, Marcus Morrison, Andre McNeil, and Geraldine Towers. Tell me, Republicans, what you say. We cannot rest. The Congressional Black Caucus will not rest. We ask all of my colleagues to sign on to the resolution that denounces this. Let's hold people accountable, but let's hold the right people accountable. And that's the Republican Party. Thank you so much. And just in case you didn't know, let me remind you, I'm Congresswoman Joyce Beatty, chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, and I approve this message. And now I have the distinct honor to introduce, speaking today on behalf of KPAC, my friend, my classmate, my colleague, Congressman Mark Tocano of California.
Thank you. Thank you, Joyce Beatty. I am Mark Tocano. I am standing in for Chairwoman Judy Chu for the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus. And we stand with the Congressional Black Caucus, as well as the Congressional Hispanic Caucus, we stand together as the Tri-Caucus to voice our deep, deep condemnation of the radical, extreme, and dangerous ideology of the Great Replacement Theory. It is an insidious combination of racism and anti-Semitism. Replacement theory posits that Jewish people are trying, are facilitating the replacement of the white race with people of color. This is absurd, and it is insidious, it's ugly, it's wrong, it's vile, and it was what motivated the act of domestic terrorism in Buffalo. And it's enabled by winks and nods, it's enabled by echoing, it's enabled by amplification by the Republican leadership and many Republicans in Congress and many people who hold powerful platforms that reach out to many, many people in this country. And we must say today, no longer can it be normalized in America. Radical replacement theory cannot be normalized in this country. What happened in Buffalo, unfortunately, is all too familiar in terms of the kinds of attacks that are happening on colored people, on communities of color. Just last year, a shooter targeted three Asian-owned businesses in Atlanta, Georgia, and killed eight people, six of whom were Asian women. It's not enough to continue responding to these attacks at this rate. We must prevent them from occurring in the first place. And I'm glad to be partnering with members of KPAC, the CPC, and the CAC in this important and necessary effort. And let me say this again. This past weekend, two mass shootings happened in less than 24 hours of each other. And the Republicans are not doing anything about it, much less saying anything about it. And we need to put and make sure that pluribus remains in the motto, e pluribus unum, out of many one. There are people who want to replace pluribus with something else, and that is just not acceptable. So I'd like to now introduce my good friend and fellow Californian, Representative Barbara Gahn of the Congressional Hispanic Caucus.
The Congressional Hispanic Caucus stands in solidarity with our leadership, our Tri-Caucus partners, and the people of Buffalo today against the hateful, racist violence that took place last Saturday. El Caucus Hispano del Congreso expresamos nuestra solidaridad con nuestros líderes, nuestros socios del Tri-Caucus, y la gente de Buffalo hoy contra la violencia odiosa y racista que tuvo lugar el pasado sábado. Let's be clear. This was an act of domestic terrorism motivated by hateful and perverse ideology that tears at the soul of our nation. All Americans should reject the hateful lies that pit one race against another, that radicalize us and divide us, and that led to this act of racist violence we saw on Saturday that shattered the lives of 13 innocent members of the Buffalo community, of which 10 of those that were murdered were Black. Our Latino community has experienced this same domestic extremism brought on by this hateful theory. In 2019, in our colleague Veronica Escobar's district, a white gunman went hunting for Latinos in El Paso at a Walmart. Like the murderer on Saturday, he was fed hateful lies and disinformation about Latinos and was radicalized by the constant stream of hate. We are seeing radical right-wing terrorism continue to grow. Several Republicans either actively talk about or hint at a validation for this racist replacement conspiracy theory, including in their leadership, while others stand by silently so they don't upset their base. Certain news agencies, alleged news agencies, and the former president, and several of his hate-filled advisors and others on the right continue to peddle this horrific and deadly lie. Those members not actively and loudly denouncing the racist language and actions and talk of invaders changing the electorate in this country, knowingly, full well know that there's potential damage of this violent rhetoric, bear the responsibility for these acts. We demand accountability for those in Congress and in social media that perpetuate this deadly ideology. The president called on Americans to seek a more perfect union, one that embraces the diversity that has made us the strongest and the most dynamic nation in the history of the world. At the Congressional Hispanic Caucus, we embrace this diversity, and we come together with our friends at the Tri-Caucus and all members of Congress to denounce hate in all of its forms. En el Caucus Hispano del Congreso, abrazamos esta diversidad y nos unamos con nuestros amigos del Tri-Caucus y a todos los miembros del Congreso para denunciar el odio en todas sus formas. Gracias. And with that, I would like to introduce my colleague from New York who had this horrific attack happen in his district, Congressman Brian Higgins.
Thank you very much. On behalf of the good people of Buffalo and a grieving neighborhood and community, I want to thank all of you for your words of kindness and compassion. All of us here are in the business of wanting better for our communities, for our nation, and for the world. This was a vile, racist act of terrorism inflicted on good, innocent people of Buffalo. The shooting started at 2:30 on Saturday afternoon, was over by 2:35. 5 minutes, one shooter with an assault weapon, 10 people dead, 3 people injured, 11 of the 13 people shot were black. The victims were ages 32 through 86. They were mothers and grandmothers, fathers and grandfathers, young adults, good people of faith, a retired teacher, a retired police officer. President Joe Biden and the First Lady were in Buffalo on Tuesday. Our community is grateful for their visit. They are warm, gracious people. They spend generous private time with the families of the victims. Joe Biden knows compassion and empathy because he has known pain and suffering in his own life. The Greeks say that we suffer our way to wisdom. To live is to suffer. To endure the suffering is to give the suffering meaning. It is an unwanted wisdom, but it is wisdom still. Suffering can break people, but can also break them open. It can make them more caring, more sensitive to the suffering of others. After loss, people change. They may not understand what happened or why, but they can be more understanding of others and seek to be better people working to make a better world. So today we mourn the victims of this senseless tragedy. We honor them and celebrate the good lives they lived. We ask the good Lord to look after them and the family, friends, and communities they left behind. And I ask all of us, as members of Congress, to do better, to fight hate in this world and in this country. Thank you, and I would now like to turn it over to our esteemed Speaker of the House of Representatives, the Honorable Nancy Pelosi.
Mr. Higgins' statement was one of beauty and unity and kindness and compassion. When we had the moment of silence on the floor the other day, he stood up and said, "We have a moment of silence now, but tomorrow our voices will speak out." And that is what has been happening this week. And as we all agree, much more needs to be done. Right away on the floor, we had Congresswoman Marsha Mitchell's anti-Semitism resolution. Yesterday, we had Mr. Schrader's bill to stop domestic terrorism. And here we are now on the steps of the Capitol. We come here when it is of the highest priority. When you talk, Mr. Higgins, of the victims and give their ages, we know there are many, many more victims. A little boy whose father was buying a birthday cake for him in the store. The members of the families of the victims have endless grief. And while we mourn with them and we pray with them, we must do more. We must stop the violence. Part of that is keeping our promise to make sure that we give our children healthy environments in which they can thrive without being fearful of gun violence. We have voted over and over again in the House for background checks for Mr. Clyburn's legislation, the South Carolina loophole. We will not rest until the job is done, and we want the victims of gun violence to know that. But all of this is compounded by the replacement theory. It's an extremely alarming and despicable idea, and it must be rejected by anyone who claims to embrace our American ideals. It's spread by social media algorithms, where people find people who think the way they do in an evil way, promoted on top television networks, yes it is, and trafficked, as has been mentioned here, by leading political figures. Why isn't everyone in this Congress saying, I reject replacement theory? Our domestic terrorism legislation we passed last night is a strong statement to save lives and protect communities. Because this is not just an assault on a person, their family, it alters the character of communities in our country if people have to be so fearful. But let me be clear, the motivation for this is something that must be rejected. Was there no one, no neighbor, no family member, no person in the store where this stuff was bought? Was there no one in the sense of community of this assailant that knew something should be called to the attention of law enforcement? We must all be vigilant until we are all faithful to the Imperialist Green Doctrine. When we had the January 6th assault on the Capitol, which had the same racist elements to it, replacement theory background to it, I read a poem. I'm not going to read all of it here, but I'll read from it. It's called I Have No Other Country by Ehud Manor, an Israeli poet. He said, I have no other country, even though my land is burning. Here is my home, I shall not be silent, for my country has changed her face. I will not give up on her, I shall remind her and sing into her ears until she opens her eyes. America, open your eyes to this hateful replacement theory that is taking lives and taking a toll on the spirit of democracy in our country. This country is about freedom. We respect that. It's about safety. We must have that, and we will not rest until the job is done. I thank my colleagues, the chairs of the Tri-Caucus, the Congressional Black Caucus, the Hispanic Caucus, and the Asian Pacific American Caucus for bringing us together today under the leadership of our distinguished witness, House Democratic Witness, Mr. Clyburn. And thank you to all of our members who took the time to be with us, and now we take the message home with us until the job is done. Our prayers are with those who lost their lives and their families. May they rest in peace. Thank you.
Thank you. good. How are you?
Yeah,